Hi, my name is Bill Ramos. I'm a senior product manager for Babelfish on the Aurora Postgres service team. And I'd like to share with you the key things you need to know on how you can accelerate your SQL Server database modernization efforts with Babelfish on Aurora Postgres. We hear from customers on a daily basis. They want to move off of their legacy commercial databases because they're too expensive, they're proprietary, they lock customers in, and they offer punitive licensing terms that come with frequent audits from those vendors that can sometimes be quite hostile in making sure that you're compliant with their licensing agreements. And for these reasons, customers are trying to move as fast as they can to open source databases such as MySQL, MariaDB, and PostgreSQL. Now, the idea is, what can you do to reduce the migration costs? A typical migration effort using the current tools today, you need to consider these 12 steps of migration. You have to think about your future state architecture. Where do you want to be in 3 to 6 months? Where do you want to be in 3 years? To think about how you can take advantage of AWS native cloud services like Aurora Postgres and other services like Amazon Redshift, AWS Glue, and so on, to build on the modernization efforts for your applications. You want to think about what's the effort to convert the database schema that includes the tables, constraints, defaults, stored procedures, views, functions, you name it, whatever there's there, how do you get that into from SQL Server to the Postgres environment? Now, the thing that you really have to concern yourself with is the application conversion. If you're going from a SQL Server directly to Postgres, you have to think about, what do I have to do for my native client drivers and converting those from using SQL Server connections to Postgres connections and all the differences that are with the given platform. Don't forget your ETL jobs, your reports, other scripts that are available, even Excel workbooks. Other reports that you have to consider, third-party applications. What else is connecting to that database that is going to need that data, and you've got to make sure that that works. How are you going to do database migrations? You know, so handling that full load and then doing things like a continuous replication afterwards until you're ready to cut over to production. How do you do testing and bug fixing? You know, you've got to think about what are the frameworks you have that are already running on SQL Server. You've got to get them to run on Postgres. So with that in mind, we created Babelfish, which is part of the Amazon Aurora Postgres service. It is included when you create an Aurora Postgres cluster. So it's free of charge in that regard. There's no additional cost. And the whole idea is with Babelfish, it supports commonly used T-SQL and semantics of those T-SQL statements to reduce the amount of code changes that are needed for making database calls in your application. So as a result, the amount of application code you need to rewrite shrinks dramatically, reducing any of the risk with new application errors when you move to, say, if you were to try to move to native Postgres. Now, with that, I just want to be very clear that when you do a migration to Babelfish, what we're doing is we're running native Postgres for the backend database, but we've introduced the T-SQL language extension and T-SQL data types that gives you that semantic support, the T-SQL behaviors, so that you can keep your queries. And so the idea is we want to be able to allow you to take the savings that you get from not having to pay SQL Server licensing and use that to fund these migration efforts. And then going on, you don't have to worry about ongoing licensing costs for those SQL Server applications because they'll now run on Babelfish. More importantly, you also have the freedom to innovate because you can continue to do new applications in Transact SQL. You can start to fold in functionality of the Postgres native functions. So there's a whole set of extensions and functions that are available that you can use to do things that you could have only imagined in the past with SQL Server using these Postgres functions. And then likewise, you can use our interop capability where you can, for example, create a Postgres very specific stored procedure that is callable by Transact SQL. And then likewise, you can have a Postgres native app calling into Babelfish objects as you need to. So you have the complete freedom to innovate. And with that, the idea is we take this original chart and the level of effort that they have and be able to reduce those costs with Babelfish. So for example, with database schema conversion, you're just running T-SQL and it's all maintained for you. You just have to modify the different things that may not be supported by Babelfish, or there's some workarounds that you need to do. And so it's not a zero cost, but it's close to zero. Likewise, your application conversion is dramatically reduced because you're using the same T-SQL client providers, whether it's OLADB, ODBC, JDBC, .NET Framework, ADO.NET, whatever it happens to be. You can still use those application interfaces to interact with the Babelfish database. Now, one of the things you have to do to kind of understand what you're going to be up against is we have an assessment tool called Babelfish Compass. It is in open source. It's released on a regular basis, meaning every time a new release of Babelfish comes out that are tied to the Aurora Postgres minor and major versions, we update Babelfish Compass with the latest improvements that we've made to the product. And it's in there. So we've got a download site on GitHub along with the user guide that gives you all the information. And we'll show you how that kind of works a little later. So let's take a look at Babelfish in action. So what I'm going to do is flip over to my screen. And I want to show you how you would run a Babelfish Compass report. So I have a script of stored procedures and views that are in the out of the GitHub repository for SQL Server samples that has the procedures and views in it. And what I'm going to do is create a Babelfish Compass assessment report for this by specifying the Babelfish compass.bat file, the name of the Babelfish report here, which I'm going to add in now just a one. You provide it the script name, and the script name is the one that you see above. We use the rewrite option to go ahead and rewrite any syntax that may not be fully compatible. And the report XREF option, which I always recommend that you use, will allow you to get a report in HTML with hyperlinks back to the original code. So it makes it easier to understand what's going on. So it only takes a few seconds to run. There's a little executive summary that gives you a list of objects that were there, and then the features that were unsupported. In this case, there was just one. I can see which object was not supported by clicking on the XREF not supported by object. And I can see here, it's a procedure 10 most expensive products. I can go ahead and click on this. And what it will do is take me to the actual database file that it evaluated. And it said in line 343 that I need to do the row count. As part of a migration effort, is you'll go ahead and open up the connection to your Babelfish cluster that you created. And that would have been, again, done with RDS. And right here, I'll just flip to this window to give you an idea. You're going to create a database. You're going to choose Aurora Postgres compatible. Fill all the various options here. The one thing I want to stress is use the most recent major version, minor version of Aurora Postgres. That has the latest and greatest features for Babelfish. You're going to fill out the requirements as you need to for a normal cluster. We've got great information in our documentation on how to do that. But I want to point out the most critical step is turn on Babelfish. And so what that will do is install the language extensions that are needed to support the Transact SQL connection. And also you're going to need to go down to the additional configuration, create a new configuration file. You want to have a naming that indicates the version that it's part of. Select multiple databases. This will allow you virtual multiple databases on top of a single Postgres Babelfish underscore DB, and specify your TDS port, in this case 1433, and that's all you need to do. Now, when you connect in Management Studio, what you're going to, after you've created your cluster, you're going to get the cluster reference here, and you'll click on that, and that will take you to the connectivity and security. You're going to want to take the endpoint name, this is basically going to be the server you're connecting to, and copy that to the clipboard. So what you're going to do is in Management Studio, take that string. I like to use registered servers up here, and what I do is I add the registered server. And so if I go ahead and click and go to properties, I'll put in that cluster name here, use SQL authentication, choose my account, SA account that I used when I created the cluster, and my password, and I set that up here. So once I do that, I've got my connection set up. I can connect to my database. You'll normally use Management Studio then to then take your scripts, for example. I can use a database, and so this will actually create the connection. Just to show you here that I have the Northwind database, we support metadata that similar to what you would normally expect in SQL Server. Now, I've already created the tables, so you know I can see them here in sys.tables, for example. And the way I did that is I basically took the table DDL with just the primary key. So what I like to do is use an approach where create the bare bones table definition and then generate another script with all the table constraints, the defaults, foreign keys, that kind of thing, put them in a separate file, and then I have a separate file for programming objects, sometimes a separate one for view and a separate one for stored procedures and functions and so on. And so basically you run the script, that creates all the tables, and then you'll use the database migration service as a way to copy that data. So you use this thing called a replication instance. This provides the compute for doing the data migration. You specify the endpoints, which will go ahead and you'll specify the Aurora Postgres endpoint for your target. And with that, you're going to point to Babelfish DB. We have great instructions in the DMS help topic for the Postgres endpoint target that explains what you need to do with that. And then you set up, in this case, I've got an RDS instance as my source where I specify the Northwind database. Then you also define a set of database migration tasks that will go ahead and copy the data over. And there's a set of transformations that you'll create as part of that. And when you do that and you run it, it will go ahead and copy the data over. Here's an example of what you see on what happens in the data load, and it gives you the ability to see over here how many rows were copied. Now, I've already done that all for you, and what I'm going to do is use a little trick in Management Studio to wrap this up, where I can go ahead and create a new query against both my RDS instance and my Babelfish instance, and then when I go ahead and open up a script file that I can use to test, I'll go ahead and select my quick test check. And when I do this, again, this is just a Management Studio feature. It's been around since 2008 release in Management Studio. You can go ahead and execute that statement. It's executing both against both the SQL Server and the Babelfish instance. And then when I run this query to check the first 10 rows, you can see here the data matches up with what I have in my SQL Server. So what we're looking at is the results of the query against my RDS instance and my SQL Server instance and the binary data that happened to be associated in this table. So those are the core essential steps that are associated with getting up and running in Babelfish. We have some great resources for you. We have a series of blog articles associated with Babelfish in the database blog. We have an open source site, babelfishpg.org, that has all the details on how Babelfish runs underneath the covers. Also, we have our GitHub repository. The nice thing about GitHub is you can submit new feature requests through issues that way in the open source repository. And then we also have a YouTube channel that we're building out with Babelfish videos. With that, thank you very much for taking the time to learn about how you can modernize your SQL Server applications with Babelfish.